Hello everyone, welcome to this session on joints of the lower limb. In this session, we'll be revising all the joints of the lower limb. Okay? So here I've listed down the major joints of the lower limb, hip joint, knee joint, and ankle joint. These are the joints which are most frequently asked in examination. So we'll be covering these joints under all these headings. Okay? And for remaining joints, I'll cover the types of the joints. Okay? Just like I covered the upper limb quick revision session in the previous video, I'll be covering the lower limb session as well. Okay, so let's start with the hip joint. So hip joint is which type of joint? It is an example of a ball and socket variety of synovial joint. Okay, and what are the articular surfaces which form the hip joint? This is the head of the femur, which forms the ball component of the ball and socket, and this is the acetabulum of the hip bone, which forms the socket. Okay, and in this particular articular surface is referred to as the lunate surface. Okay, it's a horseshoe shaped surface in the acetabulum which articulates with the head of the femur. Okay, then various ligaments of the hip joint. Since hip joint is a synovial joint, it will have a fibrous capsule covering it. So capsular ligament is the first ligament which we can remember. Then with respect to the hip bone, we can remember three ligaments. From ilium to the femur, there is iliofemoral ligament. Then from ischium to the femur is ischiofemoral ligament. And from pubis to the femur is pubofemoral ligament. Okay. Then other ligaments are, there is a transverse acetabular ligament in this region, and there's a ligament from the head of the femur. Okay, ligamentum teres femoris. Okay, so I'll repeat all the ligaments of the hip joint. One is the fibrous capsule, then iliofemoral ligament, ischiofemoral ligament, pubofemoral ligament, transverse acetabular ligament, and ligament of the head of the femur. Okay, then let's cover the various relations of the hip joint. For relations of the hip joint, there is a simplified schematic diagram. First, orient yourself towards the image. So this is the region of the hip joint. This region is the anterior part, and superior, posterior, and inferior. Okay. So which all structures form the anterior relations of the hip joint? So all these structures: the straight head of the rectus femoris and tendon of the iliopsoas. The iliacus and psoas major muscle together are referred to as iliopsoas. Okay, and then there is a synovial bursa just beneath the psoas major. Okay, it is also referred to as sub psoas bursa. Then the contents of the femoral triangle, femoral vein, artery, and nerve, and also a small part of pectineus comes in the anterior relation. Okay, let's see the superior relations of the hip joint. So in the superior relation, one, there is reflected head of the rectus femoris. Straight head was in the anterior relation, reflected head is in the superior relation. Okay, apart from that, there are three glutei muscles. Okay, gluteus maximus, medius, and minimus. And when we see the posterior relation, gluteus maximus, it's seen in the superior relation as well, it's seen in the posterior relation as well. Okay, and there are many structures under the cover of the gluteus maximus. So the spiriformis, sciatic nerve, obturator internus with two gamelli, quadratus femoris, and nerve to quadratus femoris. All these structures are in the posterior relation. Okay. Then let's see the inferior relation. There are two structures listed. One is obturator externus muscle and medial circumflex femoral artery. Okay. So these are the various relations of the hip joint. Let's cover the bursae surrounding the hip joint. Bursae surrounding the hip joint, with respect to the gluteus maximus, there are four bursa. Then with gluteus medius, one bursa; gluteus minimus, one bursa; and with psoas major, there is one bursa. Okay, that's how we can remember around seven bursa around the hip joint. Let's cover the bursae surrounding the gluteus maximus. One bursa is near the origin on along the gluteal surface of the hip bone, okay, just below the posterior gluteal line. Then there is one bursa near the graded trochanter, the trochanteric bursa, and near ischial tuberosity is the ischial bursa, and near the insertion of the gluteus maximus there is gluteofemoral bursa. Okay, then insertion of gluteus medius, near the insertion of gluteus medius along the lateral aspect of greater trochanter there is one bursa. Then along the anterior aspect of the greater trochanter near the insertion of gluteus minimus there is one bursa, and one bursa was just behind the sauce major, which we also saw in the anterior relations of the hip joint, right? Okay, so these are the various bursa. Let's cover the blood supply and the nerve supply of the hip joint. So blood supply will be by the blood vessels which are surrounding the hip joint. So which vessels are surrounding? There is the medial circumflex femoral artery, there is lateral circumflex femoral artery. These two are branches from the profunda femoris artery, which itself is a branch from the femoral artery. Okay, then apart from that there is superior gluteal artery, inferior gluteal artery, as well as obturator artery. Okay, so there is a major blood vessels which supply the hip joint. The nerve supply of the hip joint will be again by the nerves surrounding the hip joint. So on the anterior aspect there is femoral nerve. It supplies the hip joint through the nerve to rectus femoris. Then there will be obturator nerve. Okay, and on the posterior aspect there is nerve to quadratus femoris and also superior gluteal nerve. Okay, and sciatic nerve is seen close to the hip joint, but it occasionally supplies the hip joint. Okay, let's cover the movements of the hip joint. As hip joint is a multi-axial synovial joint, multiple movements are possible: flexion, extension, adduction, abduction, medial rotation, and lateral rotation. Okay, flexion is brought about by psoas major and iliacus. These are the chief flexors, and there are some accessory muscles as well. For example, in Tokyo, at least we should remember the chief muscles which is producing that particular action. Okay. Then extension is brought about by gluteus maximus. Accessory muscle is hamstring. Then abduction is by gluteus medius and minimus. These are the chief abductors. Then adduction by adductor longus, brevis, magnus. Okay. Then medial rotation by anterior fibers of gluteus medius and minimus. In general, gluteus medius and minimus, they will cause abduction. Specifically, the anterior fibers will cause medial rotation at the hip joint. Okay, and lateral rotation is brought about by short lateral rotators. Okay, so which are the short lateral rotators? Piriformis, obturator externus, then obturator internus with two gamellae, and quadratus femoris. Okay, all these muscles are included in short lateral rotators, which will rotate the hip joint laterally. Okay, let's cover the applied anatomy of the hip joint. In the hip joint, dislocation of the hip joint is common, amongst which congenital dislocation is more common as compared to that of the acquired dislocation. Head of the femur is displaced posteriorly. Okay, and Peirce disease is referred to as flattening of the head of the femur. Okay, that's also referred to as pseudo coxalgia. Then coxa, vara, and valga, these refer to the change in the neck shaft angle. Normal neck shaft angle is about 125 degrees. If there is decrease in the neck shaft angle, it is referred to as coxa vara. Increase in the neck shaft angle is referred to as coxa valga. Okay, then osteoarthritis is inflammation of the hip joint. Then referred pain of the hip joint, it may be felt in the knee joint as well, because obturator nerve which supplies the hip joint also supplies the knee joint. Okay, then fracture of the neck of the femur is very common in old age, and it is further of two types: intracapsular fracture and extracapsular fracture. In the intracapsular fracture there are various subtypes: subcapital, basal, cervical. The intracapsular fracture of neck of femur has got certain complications as well, because of the damage to the retinacular vessels which supplies the head of the femur. Complication which is referred to as avascular necrosis. Okay, it's common when there is intracapsular fracture of the neck of the femur. Okay, this was all about the hip joint. Let's move on to the knee joint. Let's start with the knee joint now. Knee joint is which type of joint? It is an example of a compound, complex, modified hinge variety of synovial joint. Okay. So why compound? Because more than two bones are taking part in the formation of the joint. And why complex? Because an articular disc is present in between the joint cavities. Okay. Then why modified hinge variety? Because the transverse axis in which flexion and extension takes place, it is not stable, it slightly moves during the movement. Okay, that's why modified. And hinge variety, because movements are along a transverse axis. Okay. And articular surfaces formed by the inferior surface of the condyles of the femur, then superior surface of the condyles of the tibia, and the posterior surface of the patella. Okay. Fibula doesn't take part in the formation of knee joint. And let's cover the various ligaments of the knee joint. So the knee joint ligaments, we can divide into chief ligaments and secondary ligaments. Chief ligaments are fibrous capsule, also referred to as the capsular ligament, since it is a synovial joint, it is having this. Then ligamentum patellae, here we can see this is the ligamentum patellae. The quadriceps femoris tendon, its primary insertion is on the patella, which extends as the ligamentum patellae, which goes up to the tibial tuberosity. Okay. And tibial and the fibular collateral ligament. So tibial collateral ligament is on the medial side, this one, and fibular collateral ligament is this one. Okay. Then anterior and the posterior cruciate ligament. These are seen on the interior of the knee joint. This is a schematic diagram to see the interior. This is the anterior part. So this ligament, which we can see, this is the anterior cruciate ligament. And this one is the posterior cruciate ligament. Okay, they are named according to their attachment on the tibia. Then menisci, medial and lateral. This is the medial meniscus. This is the lateral meniscus. Okay, just appreciate the shape of this meniscus. This medial meniscus is semicircular and the lateral meniscus is almost circular. Okay, smaller as compared to that of the medial meniscus. Let's look at the secondary ligaments of the knee joint. The oblique popliteal ligament. Here we can see this is the oblique popliteal ligament. It's an extension from the semimembranosus muscle. There is arcuate popliteal ligament, this one. Then transverse ligament. It connects the anterior ends of the two menisci. This one is the transverse ligament. And coronary ligament. It's between the peripheral margins of the menisci and the tibia. Okay? So it helps in attaching the peripheral margins of the menisci to the peripheral margins of the condyles of the tibia. Okay? These are the various ligaments of the knee joint. Let's cover the relations and bursae surrounding the knee joint. So the four headings in relations: anterior, posterolateral, posteromedial, and posterior. Anterior relations include the prepatellar bursa and ligamentum patellae. Posterolateral relations include the biceps femoris, common fibular nerve. The word peroneal is replaced by fibular. Okay. Then plantaris and the lateral head of the gastrocnemius. Okay. So all these are in the posterolateral relations. Let's see the posteromedial relations. Posteromedial relations, there is sartorius gracilis and semitendinosus, the SGS muscles. Okay. Then semimembranosus and the medial head of the gastrocnemius. Then in the posterior relation, there is tibial nerve, popliteal vessels, and the oblique popliteal ligament. So these are the various relations of the knee joint. Let's quickly cover the bursae surrounding the knee joint as well in this image. On the anterior aspect with relation to the patella, we can see one bursa, the prepatellar bursa. There are a few other bursa in relation to the patella. One we can see that is the prepatellar bursa. And there is subcutaneous intrapatellar bursa. And there is deep intrapatellar bursa and suprapatellar bursa. Okay, these are the four bursa in relation to the patella. Then along the posterolateral aspect, there is a bursa between the tendon of the biceps femoris and the fibular collateral ligament. So here there will be a bursa. And between fibular collateral ligament and tendon of popliteus, there is a bursa here. And between tendon of popliteus and the lateral condyle of the femur, there'll be one more bursa. Okay, so three bursa in the posterior lateral region, and in the posterior medial region, we can remember this semimembranosus muscle. There's a bursa between semimembranosus and the tibial collateral ligament. There is one bursa between semimembranosus and the medial condyle of the tibia. Okay, and this SGS muscles, we know, sartorius gracilis semitendinosus, there's a bursa which separates them, that is anserine bursa. Okay, so anserine bursa, bursa between semimembranosus and tibial collateral ligament, bursa between semimembranosus and the medial condyle of the tibia. Then along the posterior aspect, deep to the medial head and the lateral head of the gastrocnemius, there is one bursa each. Okay, so there were four bursa here on the anterior aspect in relation to the patella, three bursa near the posterior lateral aspect, then three bursa in the posterior medial aspect, and two bursa along the posterior aspect. Okay, so there are many bursa in relation to the knee joint. Let's cover the blood supply and the nerve supply of the knee joint. So blood supply to the knee joint will be by the surrounding blood vessels. On the posterior aspect of the knee joint, we know there is popliteal artery which gives genicular branches. Okay, so there is middle genicular artery, superior medial genicular artery, superior lateral genicular artery, inferior medial and inferior lateral genicular artery. Okay, so five genicular arteries of popliteal artery, they will supply, as well as there is lateral circumflex femoral artery that also supplies knee joint. Then there are recurrent branches from the vessels of the leg. Okay, which are the vessels of the leg? The anterior tibial artery, the posterior tibial artery, right? So recurrent branches from that will supply. From the posterior tibial artery, there is a specific branch called as circumflex fibular artery, which gives the recurrent branch. And nerve supply of the knee joint will be by the surrounding nerves. So there will be femoral nerve, obturator nerve, the tibial nerve, and common fibular nerve. Okay, these are the major nerves which are surrounding the knee joint, so that will supply it. Let's cover the movements of the knee joint. Movements are flexion, extension, as well as in semi-flex position, two other movements are possible, medial rotation and lateral rotation. So flexion is brought about chiefly by the hamstring muscles, the semimembranosus, semitendinosus, and biceps femoris. Extension is brought about by quadriceps femoris. Okay, there are some accessory muscles as well. And in medial rotation, again the muscles of flexion are featuring here, the semitendinosus, semimembranosus, as well as there is one muscle, popliteus. Okay, and lateral rotation is by biceps femoris muscle. Okay, when we learn about the movements of the knee joint, there is one specific movement which needs to be learnt in details, that is locking and unlocking of the knee joint. So here we can see the locking and unlocking of the knee joint. So we should know what is locking and unlocking and which muscle produces locking and unlocking. Okay, locking of the knee joint is referred to as medial rotation of the femur on the tibia during terminal stages of extension. Okay, why the knee gets locked? Because the quadriceps femoris muscle, it can get relaxed and the person can stand for a prolonged period without much muscular effort. Okay, then unlocking is lateral rotation of femur of the tibia during initial stages of the flexion. Okay, this is brought about by quadriceps femoris, and unlocking is brought about by popliteus muscle. Okay, locked knee is rigid and unlocked knee can be further flexed. In locked knee, all ligaments get taut, and in unlocked knee, the ligaments are relaxed. Okay, this topic is very important. Most commonly asked as a short note in examination. Now let's cover the applied anatomy with relation to the knee joint. So knee joint is one of the most common joint to be affected by osteoarthritis. Then cruciate ligament injuries, in which the anterior cruciate ligament injury is more common as compared to that of the posterior cruciate ligament. Then in meniscal tears also, medial meniscus is more prone to injury as compared to lateral meniscus. Then housemaid's knee is inflammation of the prepatellar bursa. clergyman's knee is inflammation of the subcutaneous intrapatellar bursa. Okay. Then Baker's cyst is the cystic swelling of the bursa deep to the semimembranosus muscle. Okay. Then arthroscopy of the knee joint is now frequently performed to visualize the interior of the knee joint, and as well as certain therapeutic corrections can be done through the scope which is passed inside the joint. There's something called as unhappy triad of the knee joint, in which three structures are involved. One is the medial collateral ligament, then anterior cruciate ligament, and medial meniscus. Okay, so if these three structures together are involved, they're referred to as unhappy triad of the knee joint. Okay. Let's start with the ankle joint now. Ankle joint is which type of joint? It is an example of a hinge variety of synovial joint, because movement is along a transverse axis. Okay. Articular surfaces. The proximal articular surface is formed by tibia as well as fibula. It's referred to as the tibiofibular mortise. It's formed by the inferior surface of the tibia as well as the medial surface of the fibula. Then the superior surface of the talus. Okay. So all these are the articular surfaces. Then ligaments of the ankle joint. Since it is a synovial joint, the first ligament which we can remember is the fibrous capsule or the capsular ligament. The other ligaments are the medial collateral ligament and the lateral collateral ligament. Medial ligament is also referred to as deltoid ligament, which has got further parts. The medial ligament, when we study, we have to remember the tibia. Medial ligament starts with tibia, and when we study the lateral ligament, you have to remember the fibula, and the lateral ligament ends in fibula. Okay, so how we can see here, from the tibia it is starting, the tibiotalar, anterior tibiotalar and posterior tibiotalar. This one is anterior tibiotalar, this one is posterior tibiotalar. Then from tibia to the calcaneus is tibiocalcanean, this one. And this is tibio-navicular. Okay, so these are the various medial ligaments. Lateral ligaments are, it starts from talus and goes up to the fibula. So anterior talofibular, posterior talofibular, and calcaneofibular. Okay. Now let's cover the relations of the ankle joint. So here we can see anterior relations as well as posterior relations. For anterior relation, we can easily remember by a mnemonic. Tall, Himalayas are never dry places. Okay, so if you remember the mnemonic, we can try to correlate with the structure surrounding that region. So on the anterior aspect, the muscle is tibialis anterior, and H for extensor hallucis longus, A for anterior tibial artery, N for the nerve on the anterior aspect, there is deep fibular nerve, then D for the extensor digitorum longus, and P for the peroneus tertius. Okay, its correct name now is fibularis tertius. Okay, and similarly the posterior relations can be remembered by a mnemonic: talented doctors are never hungry. Okay, on the posterior aspect, the T will stand for the tibialis posterior muscle, and D stands for the flexor digitorum longus muscle. The artery is posterior tibial artery. Nerve is posterior tibial nerve, and H stands for the flexor hallucis longus muscle. Okay, so relations medial to lateral made easy by these two mnemonics. And blood supply and nerve supply with respect to the ankle joint. So blood vessels will be by the surrounding vessels. So we know there is anterior tibial artery, posterior tibial artery, so that will supply the ankle joint. Then nerve supply will be by the surrounding nerves. On the anterior aspect, there is deep fibular nerve. On the posterior aspect, there is tibial nerve. Okay. In the blood supply also, there will be some contribution from the fibular artery. Okay. Then let's cover the movements of the ankle joint. And since it is a hinge joint, two movements are possible: dorsiflexion and plantar flexion. And the muscles producing these movements, dorsiflexion will be brought about by muscles of the anterior compartment of the leg. The tibial is anterior is the chief dorsiflexor, and the remaining muscles will be referred to as accessory muscles. Similarly, in plantar flexion, the chief muscle will be soleus and gastrocnemius. Okay, rest of the muscles will be considered as accessory muscles. Let's cover the applied anatomy with respect to the ankle joint. So, ankle sprains are common in which the ligaments are injured, in which the anterior talofibular ligament is the most commonly injured ligament. Okay, then dislocation of the ankle joint may occur. Quad fracture is referred to as fracture dislocation. There will be fracture in this region as well as dislocation of the joint. Fracture usually occurs of the malleolus, the medial malleolus, lateral malleolus, as well as there is a third malleolus which is described in the ankle joint, that is the posterior margin of the tibia, that is referred to as the third malleolus. Okay, so if all three are involved, it is referred to as trimalleolar quad fracture. Then optimum position of the ankle. Whenever a plaster cast has to be applied in this region, the cast is applied in such a way that the ankle is in slight plantar flexion. Okay. So let's summarize what we have covered in this particular session, and also I'll cover the types of the other joints of the lower limb. Okay. So for hip joint, knee joint, and ankle joint, we covered in detail. So all are synovial type, and the subtype for hip joint is ball and socket, for knee is modified hinge, and for ankle is the hinge joint. Okay. Then tibiofibular joints. Here we can see the tibiofibular joints, superior, middle, and inferior. The superior tibiofibular is a plain variety of synovial joint, whereas other two are fibrous type of joint. Okay. So this is a thin desmosis. And subtalar joint is a plain variety of synovial joint. In subtalar joint, there are actually two components, posterior talocalcaneal joint and anterior talocalcaneal joint. The posterior talocalcaneal joint is specifically referred to as subtalar joint. Okay, and anterior talocalcaneal joint, it is a component of this joint, that is the talocalcaneonavicular joint, and this joint is referred to as ball and socket, a variety of synovial joint. Okay. Then calcaneocuboid joint, here we can see this is the calcaneocuboid joint. It is a saddle variety of synovial joint. And tarsometatarsal joint, it is a plain variety of synovial joint. Intermetatarsal joints are also plain variety. Then joints between the metatarsal and the phalanges, these are ellipsoid variety of synovial joint. And interphalangeal joint are hinge variety of synovial joint. Okay. So we have covered all the joints of the lower limb. So for PDF handout, you all can WhatsApp me at this number, and please do watch other sessions of this YouTube channel. Okay. Thank you.